Okay, now I have a microphone. I don't know if it's better or worse. I'll keep it until you complain. Okay, so I want to just recap where we stand and tell you roughly where we are going to. So we are looking at the operator scaling problem. And what we arrived at the end of the lecture yesterday was that this amazing paper of Gurwitz that some of it I told you about, and I'll say a few more words about it. The setup is that we have a couple of matrices. We started by looking at it as a symbolic matrix, and we will return to looking at it as a symbolic matrix to rank or non-commutative rank we are interested in. But we saw Gurwitz introduced another way of looking at it as an operator on matrices. Okay? So you can think of this tuple as just an operator on matrices. And then with this you can apply the analog of the matrix scaling algorithm to this operator in order to get it doubly stochastic. I didn't write what doubly stochastic means. So this is the operator and there is a dual, and what we want doubly stochastic was the L tau I. It's like row and column sum I equal to 1. And this was the alternating minimization analog of the matrix scaling algorithm. We scale the rows, we scale the columns. Here scaling is a bit more complicated, but you just pre-multiply by the change basis on the left, the change basis on the right, and so you satisfy alternately one of these two conditions, and you go on for some number of steps. And that's the main difference from the matrix scaling algorithm, where we knew already how many steps we should take. Gurwitz, in his paper, didn't give a bound, although he gave a bound for a special case that was very interesting, that I'll mention in a second. But anyway, this is the algorithm, just the same. And after some number of steps, you just check that you are close enough to being doubly stochastic. This is the distance of L from satisfying both of these conditions. You want to check whether it's polynomially small or not. And when the answer is yes or no, and the question is, what do they mean? What do they mean? And so I mentioned already that they proved several theorems in the paper. And one thing we proved is that, okay, so another very important notion, which again, the generalization of the classical notion for matrix scaling, is the notion of capacity of an operator, is absolutely key to everything. And the capacity of an operator looks like a mysterious quantity. It's not clear that it gives any intuition right now. You take any input to the operator and you compare the determinant of the output to the determinant of the input. The ratio you minimize of all possible inputs that are positive definite, so you don't want to divide by zero. And the question, the key question is, how small can it get if it's non-zero? So one of the things that it proved was that if capacity is sort of analogous to the classical case, and this is the simple, capacity of L equals zero, then it does not convert. Algorithm G does not converge. Okay. And moreover, he proved that this corresponds to some algebraic property of the operator. So capacity equals zero actually corresponds to what is called rank, or what is defined as rank decreasing operator. When people in quantum information theory are looking at this kind of operator, these are positive maps or quantum channels, people call them different names. They often look at what happens to, for example, the von Neumann entropy of the density matrix we're putting. Gurwitz looked at, because he was interested in solving the singularity problem, and we'll see the connection in a second. he looked at another property, which how does the rank of the matrix report in change. So here we look at the determinant, we can look also at the rank, because it's the numeric matrix. P and L of P are just numeric matrices, complex matrices. By the way, I'm not talking about complex, but then I'll return to general fields. So right now I'm talking about the complex entries. And it proves that this is if and only if L is rank decreasing. So this analytic quantity, which we said is not a convex function even, is related to the matrix being rank decreasing. What does it mean rank decreasing? That there is some input whose rank decreases after implying this operator. So this means that there exists a P, so a positive definite matrix, so that rank, and that's the numeric rank, right, over the complex numbers, L of P is less than L of P. And we will see later, this was a very important thing for us to realize, we'll see later that this condition is exactly non-commutative singularity of this symbol. Okay, so this was not in the paper, I'll explain it later, but this condition, so everything is open. Yeah, you'll see in this, today you'll see like 5-6 different ways of expressing the condition that the matrix, the top like this, symbolic matrix, is non-commutative singular. It's amazing how many interpretations it has and how rich mathematically this is. So in particular, one way to see it is in this rank decreasing of an operator. This is exactly the same as this tuple is non-commutatively singular. So in particular, you see that there is at least one side to what we already want to obtain. If it's rank decreasing and it's non-commutatively singular, then capacity is zero and the algorithm doesn't converge, which is what we want. We also want the other thing to happen, right? We want that if it is non-singular, we want the algorithm to converge and to converge fast. So Gurwitz was not thinking about non-commutative singularity, but he was thinking about commutative singularity. And what he proved, the other thing he proved, so this is one thing, and the other thing was that if it's commutatively non-singular, okay, then the algorithm converges. Okay, so what he proved is that if L is commutatively, I'll stress it, commutatively non-singular, so really, this is L is not in what we call sin, right? Then capacity of L is bigger, a similar bound n to the minus of n, like we saw before. So some exponential bound, it's not so important. And because of this, we have polynomial convergence.
Can you remind us what is commutative and singular?
Yes. So, but let me just repeat this so it's clear. L of x, we think about it as some AI xi, the symbolic matrix, and L is singular. If and only if, for example, the determinant of f of x is identically zero, or L is not invertible in the commutative setting. So that's the commutative setting.
Okay.
Yes.
Could it some condition about the entries of the matrices to get this modular capacity?
Yes, so as I mentioned, let me repeat it again for this lecture. You should think of all the matrices I'm talking about, let's say, as having zero, one inputs. whenever they are just given as rational numbers with some bit size b, then replace n with b. Okay, so maybe I won't write it now. It's just for simplicity. I don't want to. It's just a pain, and it's not important. Yes.
I think 9.2, is it important that P is
semi-positive? Yeah. It's always very important. You want to think about just PSP, PSP matrices. Yeah. It's the only context. I mean, the operator is defined on all matrices, but the context in which it's relevant, even for this definition, is when it's a PSP matrix, and we'll see later what. Okay. So you see. The main problem is these are not complementary conditions. I already told you the end of it. Being commutatively non-singular and being rank decreasing are not non-commutatively singular. Are not complementary. We know already the answer, and this is what I told you. I will prove eventually. What we prove in this. Hopefully completely. It's the first paper. Tomorrow I'll talk maybe about the second paper. Is that if capacity of L is greater than zero, again with the 0-1 thing, then capacity of L is greater than n. Maybe it's not n squared, but maybe that's what I'll prove, but enough to show polynomial convergence. Okay. So basically, because of that, this is an algorithm for testing non-commutative singularity. So this implies that, even though I didn't show you yet, non-commutative singularity is in P. But another thing that it does, and I mentioned this yesterday, follows from a third result of Gurwitz, is that so we know what it means for capacity to be zero. It turns out that we also know exactly what it means for capacity to be one. So what he proved is that if L is doubly stochastic, and doubly stochastic means just satisfy this, right? Then the capacity is one. It's really economic. And this is a numerically stable result, so if it's very close to being doubly stochastic, it's very close to being one. Now remember what we are eventually getting. We run this polynomial amount of time, if it does converge, it converges fast to being very close to doubly stochastic. If it's very close to doubly stochastic, the capacity is one. But we can keep track of all the changes we have made, right? We can, you know, the determinants of this. I mentioned, where should I write it? I want all the Gurwitz results to be on this board. I mentioned to you that capacity is useful, like permanent, for the other algorithm because the changes are multiplicative. So let's say here, capacity, well, that was really the reason for this inequality, the ability to use AMDN is capacity of Li plus 1. But I will write it just like this. More generality. Capacity of just in general, RLC divided by capacity of L is simply the determinant of R squared times determinant C squared. And because of this, the algorithm can keep track of these matrices and can keep track of their determinant. So if it does converge without the stochastic, we actually can compute the capacity of the initial input, the initial operator, right? So this is the one consequence. Can compute, just like capacity this function can be computed or approximated arbitrarily well in P. And this will be very important for us tomorrow for the analysis application. And the third thing is that this algorithm is sort of continuous. I mean, it's numerically stable. Everything that happens here is computations on matrices. You take their inverses, of course, the entries blow up, but we can control them. So the algorithm is pretty continuous, and this will be also useful. For tomorrow, so that I leave for. Okay, so now, unless there are any questions, I'm going to go slowly towards eventually proving this, and for this we have to take several details into algebra. Yes?
So, you say that you can compute arbitrarily close approximations, so can you actually also in P figure out if the capacity is exactly one half?
No, exactly you cannot compute, but the main thing is distinction between zero and non-zero. And this you can do because if it's non-zero, if it's non-zero, it's already, there is a gap and we can approximate it well enough for that. Yeah. So you can approximate it up to exponential. Yeah.
And you find the key, like, which is the capacity?
Very good. All these questions, the answer to them is yes, but it's not in our paper, it's in the IQS paper, so I should, I will get to this, we'll talk about that, yeah. So there are, all these witnesses can be computed, the witnesses for membership in non-commutative singularity and membership for in non-singularity. Yeah. Okay, so I want to move into algebra and I just want to say something about the. So there are two fields. One is with this theorist's skew fields in non-commutative algebra, and the other is commutative invariant theory. And the realization for me that they are relevant came from a paper of myself with. So this is 1904, and then. I don't remember, maybe 4 years ago, or five years ago. this is a paper in algebraic complexity, and what we were doing there, maybe I should motivate this, because there are just great open questions there. We studied non-commutative algebraic circuits. And just a very brief summary of what's known. We mentioned that we don't have still low bounds for commutative circuits. That's a VP versus VNP question. So you can ask, what about the non-commutative model? You compute and everything is as before, and arithmetic circuits look exactly the same, except you really have to remember when you multiply which comes from the left, which comes. I'm not going to formally define it. About 35 years ago, Nam-Nissan asked this, it's ridiculous, we don't have even low bounds for this, let's prove some of them. And he proved exponential low bounds for Nissan, probably, I don't know, something like 85, exponential in N, formula, and actually also arithmetic branching programs, low bounds for, let's say, the you can say for the permanent, you can always say for the permanent, the non-commutative permanent, or for, let me just say, explicit functions. This is non-commutative polynomial. And since then, and it's still open, there is no low bound for circuits, there are low bounds for formula. Why is it so difficult? We have no idea. So in this paper, with the Pavel, we thought that it's maybe useful to make life harder for us. I say we cannot pull low bounds for non-commutative circuits with addition and multiplication. Let's add division. And maybe there's more structure, and we'll understand it, and will provide us with more tools, invariants, I don't know, something about progress measures on the objects computed. And maybe we can get, so open here, low bounds for circuits. And in this paper, we looked at circuits with division. Circuits with division in the non-commutative world. And then we have no idea what kind of, well, you can think of it positively and negatively, what kind of trap we were falling into, a rabbit hole full of surprises. Because you think division, in a commutative world, division is something that you can forget about immediately as you start thinking about it, because you can eliminate it. First of all, from the algebraic point of view, every rational function is a ratio of polynomials, so you can stick to polynomials. From a computational point of view, Strassen taught us that anything you can compute with division, you can compute without division, with slight increase in size. I'm saying all this, I don't know how many people are aware of this, so feel free to ask. This is standard in the commutative world, but we are moving to the non-commutative world. And when you start dealing with division, and we soon see, things look completely different. And it is in this world that, trying to understand this, that we understood that we need to know about skew fields. And to know about invariant theory, and I'll tell you why we theory. What we were mainly, the way we got to trying to understand, well, we needed this for division, and we realized that we need this too. We were not looking at any non-commutative singularity problem, we were just trying to maybe prove low bounds, we were trying to understand division in the non-commutative world. And in particular, can one repeat Strassen's result that division can be efficiently eliminated from the computation? So there was a question here: can division be efficiently eliminated? On non-commutative circuits and formula. And it turns out that this question, which we got into the invariant theory connections, we asked some invariant theorists like Dirksen, and because of that, there was some of the progress that I mentioned that allowed the algorithm for any field and so on. So this is by now known. A positive result by Dirksen and Markham, and this is still open. But that's the reason, I thought, just the background, why, how did we get to this. So now I want to start telling you about non-commutative fields. And okay, so questions so far. So I want to give, just because, again.
One question.
Yes.
What does?
You just invert. You have, I mean, we mentioned before, right, that in the commutative world, so you have the class times inverse, and you try to generate everything you can from you know, the variables and constants in the field. Right? That's what the surface of formula. Same. The question is, what does it mean? Okay. We get to this, but let me just say something a little. More general, just to make sure that everybody has seen this. So the context for the questions I'm going to discuss in mathematics, what people call word problems. You all know word problems. Almost in any situation where you have an interesting class of objects, typically be algebraic combinatorial object, a set of objects, there'll be many, you describe them somehow, and then this description may not be unique or canonical. So what there'll be, so this some omega here, and also there's some notion of equivalence, and all these are equivalence classes. So the basic world problem is I give you x and y and omega, and I ask you this. This is a world problem. So you know it from many places. This can be graph isomorphism problem, right? It can be whether two knots are the same. It can be whether two formulas, commutative formulas, are identical, the PIT problem. Or whether one is exactly zero, right? So this is a class, a huge class of family of problems, also very important in the early days of complexity. For example, the word problem for groups was proved to be undecidable, one of the basic problems in mathematics, first basic problems in mathematics. I give you a presentation of a group, it doesn't matter what it is if you don't know. I give you a word in it, and the question is whether this word is equal to the identity. Lots and lots of important problems fall into here. PIT falls here, that's so it's a special case of this type of problem. Also, non-commutative PIT or non-commutative singularity fall in this. So I'm going to talk about the non-commutative setting in a second. I just want to make sure that the valiant result I mentioned yesterday is familiar to everybody. So what is the valiant result? So if we have a formula, so what is an arithmetic formula? Arithmetic formula is exactly what you know. So here's the arithmetic formula. This is still commutative. So we are here still in the commutative setting. And here you have x1, x7, pi, minus 3, okay? Constants in the field and variables. That's a formula. And I want to state valiant theorem because we will soon see an analog of this. It's the completeness of the determinant for arithmetic formula. So if let's say f is a arithmetic formula just of this type, and let's say of size s, size is the number of symbols, number of leaves, okay, then there exists L sub f. So L sub f is the same symbolic matrix, right? It's a symbolic matrix in the same variables. So symbolic matrix such that and furthermore L sub f is let's say 2s by 2s. So there is always a reduction from evaluating a formula to computing a determinant. So I think it's a very powerful message that people sort of miss, and I like to tell mathematicians. Determinants pervade all subjects of mathematics. All textbooks are filled with determinants. You can ask yourself why, I mean, what's special? That's certainly the most popular polynomial in the history of mankind. Why? I mean, this is why. I mean, you can always, it's just that you can always do that. Sometimes it's especially convenient to do this, but you can always do it. Of course, also it's connections with the linear algebra and solution of equations, but this is a very powerful method that coming out of complexity, and mathematicians are not always, I mean, mostly unaware of. How many people have seen the proof of this? Really? So like almost 2,000. Okay, let me start looking at my time. I also said I have material for much more than. Okay, let me do a really quick 5 minutes proof of this. D2. Okay. I think it's very important, so everybody should have seen this. So what's the proof? How can you prove something like this? There's only one way to prove something like this. It's by induction. It's an inductive structure, right? You prove it by induction. You offer, I force you, that's what you will do. So let's check. So what can F be? Well, F can be the sum of two formulas, or it can be the product of two formulas. Well, it can be a variable, of course. Or it can be a constant in the field. So let's build the... So assume inductively we have matrices, symbolic matrices that do this. Let's see that we can inductively prove. For all the base case is very simple. This will be C, the determinant of this one by one matrix. So that's no problem. The induction, the base for the induction. Which one is easier? Times, very good. So here you would just put LG here, put LH here, put zeros here, and the determinant of this is the product of the determinant. All right, what do you do with this? Any ideas? It's not so obvious. It seems like actually it should be impossible, right? Plus and times should look. Okay. So here's what you do. It's valiant, brilliant insight. I'm not telling you how we got to it. There's a simple reason, but I want it to look like magic. So it will, to those who haven't seen it, so here is the magic. First, you do what you know, mathematicians, we are trained to, if induction doesn't work, we strengthen the inductive assumption. So it will give us leverage. So here's the inductive assumption. I'm going to insist that LF, and furthermore, LF has the following structure. It, below the diagonal, it has ones, below them it has zero, and here it can have whatever you want. So I impose further structure. Right? That's the inductive assumption, not only such an LF exists, but it looks like this. Okay? Okay. Look. Even the base doesn't work anymore, but you can fix it, right? I mean, you can make it 2 by 2, which explains this 2s. Maybe you put one here, something like this. Doesn't matter. That's okay. You have one below the diagonal, that's important.
It's okay, but it's 1 by 1, right? There was no below the diagonal.
Yeah, but you're right, but I want the ones to show. I like them though. And you'll see one. Yeah. So anyway, you can fix it. What about this? So this already have this property. What's missing? Well, this doesn't have a one. What do we do? Put it there. Don't change anything. Good. So now that's it. This we didn't ruin it. But now I'll just have a bit more room in here. How do we do this now? Well, we do the same thing. Put LH here. LGLLH. Okay, we don't touch this. Okay. We don't touch this. And now we are doing the following. We are adding one row and one column to this matrix. And we put one here, one here, one here, and one. Well, I don't put the rest are zeros, right? And please don't bug me with minus ones. You can fix minus ones, but when I say one, you can make one minus one. Okay, I claim that this does addition. So the, I claim that the determinant of f equals the determinant of, sorry, L sub f, determinant L sub g plus determinant L sub h. Why? Expand it by, let's say, the first column. If you take this, you should check, but then you're really forced to take this. And then you are forced to take this, and this, and this, and this. So this gives you 1 times the determinant of L sub h. That's 1 expansion. And if you expand taking this, then you are forced to take blah, 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 and you get the other determinant. This is it, except that it doesn't look like what we wanted to do. Doesn't have the inductive structure, right? But that's really easy to fix. You just swap these two rows. That's a proof. Okay. Questions about this? You should always remember this. In fact, you don't have to remember this, you can always reconstruct. So it's an amazing result, and very powerful, and we'll soon discuss an extension. So this, so PIT, a word problem in the commutative setting, reduces to solving a singularity problem, right, of symbolic matrix. I want to move to the notion of, so now we are non-commutative. These xi's do not commute, and the this here. So I already mentioned that just to get to the normal in the commutative setting, to get to this, you move here from the polynomial ring by adding inverse. By adding inverse, so you just add inverse to your operations, and then you get this. And these are always the members here are always p over q, where each of these are in the polynomial ring. Somehow we are lucky. This is a lucky situation. This is not going to happen here, and let me start with some examples. So first of all, there's sort of a general comment about this object, the Friskew field. I don't know if any other example in algebra, of course, I'm not my expertise. But almost every algebraic object is defined syntactically. There's a canonical, even though, if you don't care about complex issues, there is some canonical way to define objects, say supergraphically first or something. In algebra, in commutative algebra, polynomials have a canonical representation. You write down the coefficient vector of their monomials. There's a basis to this vector space, and you fix one and you. When you start trying to do the same thing, so what we are trying to do is just extend. This is a non-commutative polynomial. These are simply non-commutative. Non-commutative polynomials, you try to extend them by inverse. They by themselves have the same property. You can just, they have a canonical representation, right? The coefficient vector of all monomials. There are more monomials because you have to consider all permutations, but there's a canonical representation. Now we want to close them under inversion to get this object. And there's no known way, or well, you see a known way, but initially, there's no known way to describe them in any other way but computation. But saying, let's take the variables and constants in the field and start acting on them, building formulas by adding two, by multiplying two, and by taking the inverse. Okay, so that's how they were initially defined. The person responsible for this development is Amitsu, in the 50s and 60s. developed an amazing theory, and I will tell you just briefly about this. But first, let's just look at some examples. Even if I write, so remember, variables don't commute. If you look at this, and that's an exercise, just add two inverses of variables that do not commute. This is not well, I should write it like this, I should just write PQ inverse or P inverse Q for PQ. Should prove this. There is no way, even the simplest expression and formula are the same for me. I'm looking now at formulas just like this. Only that now the order of multiplication matters, and I also have an inverse case. So it's impossible to, so that this luck here doesn't happen at all. But things are actually worse, much worse. Consider this expression, x plus y z inverse w inverse. I will four variables. The obvious thing about this expression is that it has nested inversion. Right? There's an inverse and another inverse. In the commutative world, no problem. I mean, you can eliminate it. There's always at the end just one inverse. Well, here you can't. So, as what is called inversion height 2. Inversion height is the minimal number of inversions, you can write an equivalent expression to this. Now you can ask me what's equivalent, we'll soon see a definition of equivalent. But one good notion that I will not elaborate or write down is just, you can massage any expression by the field axioms. So you can multiply it by one maybe you want to, one is x minus x, or one is f times x inverse, or something like that. Anyway, you can start, or you want to prove an identity of two objects, you multiply them from the left by the same object, or add to them something, and so on. You can just do this, and that's one good notion of equivalence. Anyway, there is no way to write this expression without nested inverse. It's a theorem, and in fact, it's a more general theorem, very important, by Rettenauer, saying that for every n, there exists a formula, inversion height, and when I mentioned connection to formal language theory of the 60s and Kleene's results, this really intuitively followed these ideas. It's related to, Eric would know, but I don't know how many people would know about Kleene's result that there are regular languages whose regular expression requires an unlimited number of star height. And really the analogy is sort of simple, the proof is very complicated, but the analogy, you know, plus times and the inverse correspond to concatenation, union, and star in the regular language. Anyway, that's a detour. Okay, yeah, so yeah.
Question.
Go ahead.
The inverse inside
might
be two sided? Because you have left inverse and right inverse?
The inverse is the second expression and inverse. There is no, yeah, if there is a right inverse, then it's also a left inverse, even.
Like,
what is
defined that?
Yeah, yeah. It's not simple. Yeah, it's not simple. Even for two, it's not simple. Yeah, maybe it should be an exercise, but it's not so easy.
Is there some sort of power series like notion? Like yes. Star is kind of like power series.
Definitely. You can do infinite power series. That's another sort of way of dealing with all of them. Yeah. You take inverse and you write it as an infinite power series, and there's a whole theory for non-commutative. And that's actually the connection to another field I mentioned, the non-commutative control theory, where these objects appear naturally. But yeah, all these details. So let me go back to my plan, more or less. and show you that even though this has inverse height 2, if I wrote it a similar expression with just two variables, so, and then I take inverse here, this can be, you can remove the double inverse, and this turns out to be the same as x inverse minus x plus y inverse. In fact, this is called Wu's identity. You can try to prove it, it's not so difficult using field axioms. It's a fundamental theorem in projective geometry, as it turns out. And so this thing says connection to other fields of math. But anyway, we see just thinking about wealth problems and thinking about are two expressions the same. Here is an example of are two expressions the same. Okay, so we want to be able to solve this. In fact,
is it true that any trivial expressions you can prove using field axioms?
Say again?
Is it true that you can prove, if you have trivial expressions, you can always prove using
field axioms? Yes. It's yes. And let me not write it down. It's a theorem of 14 of Cohen and Rettenauer, that if two things are equivalent, then I'll define equivalence differently. But if two are equivalent, you can always prove it using the field axioms. It's not so good. You have to decide which you take as a definition and which you take. But anyway, things work out. So we have here a world problem, and this is a general, this is an example of the world problem in non-commutative skew fields. And one consequence of the results that we mentioned there is that the world problem, this world problem, is in P. That's one of the consequences of our algorithm and the IQS algorithm in any field. So this is something we don't know in the commutative field, we know in the non-commutative field. Okay, so I want to tell you two theorems that are sort of really responsible for what will follow and the connection to the capacity. Questions? Too fast, too slow?
Yeah. What is the last statement? What do you mean word problems?
This kind of, well, I mean, I put here, you know, so. Two formulas are the same, or is one the zero formula? Identity. It's just a PIT problem for formulas with inverse.
This is for formula, not circuit?
Yeah, it's for formula. You can ask the same for circuits, and I don't know the answer.
Is there a direct translation between the word problem of this setting to the kind of some sort of word problem in the language setting, the formal language setting?
There's an intuitive, to the best of my understanding, there's an intuitive connection, but not a formal connection. So the proof of Rettenauer, for example, is inspired by Kleene's proof, but it's not. You have to go through this infinite power series, and yeah, so it's not, I don't know about that. Yeah, so it's, but I mean, let's make it a challenge. Proof such an equivalent.
Sorry, I missed what you said. So this is
for
formulas, but
yeah.
Circuits you don't know.
I don't know. Yeah.
And earlier you said that a lot of these things are actually reducible to the determinant, this one too?
Yeah, there is no determinant in non-commutative setting, and you will see in a second what it is reducible to. Yeah, just give me 5 minutes. Okay, let me just see how we stand. Okay. Right. So the first thing is to define equivalence, and that's what of objects in this free skew field. So right now, the elements of this free skew field, we said that yeah, this is free skew field for me, and you can think of having any number of variables. For any formula, there will be some finite one. But. So it's just a collection of all formulas with plus time, all the times and inverse. we want to find now the finite equivalence on them. And you're not orphan.
But maybe you invert zero.
Ah, yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you. You don't. You never. And you have to know what a zero is.
Yeah.
But you should not divide, or you should not invert something that's identically zero. You have to know what identically zero means. But right. Yeah. So you never like. There's a. I think even the Hitchhiker Guide to the Galaxy, or. But definitely in this math camp that my son has attended for years, there are rules of the camp. It's a math camp, so it's, you have to be in your room by 10 and blah, blah, blah. There are five rules that you should never violate, and one of them is you should never divide by zero. So also here we don't divide by zero, but that's a good point. Amitsur wanted to define the equivalence relation. There is a very natural way to do it for getting the field axioms. It's just, when you have a formula like this, you can evaluate what elements of what will you plug in. Any ring, you have plus times inversion, you can plug in any elements in any ring. And his idea was that two expressions are equivalent. Simply, if they agree, when you evaluate them, when you plug into the variables elements of any ring. And if you think a second more, you think that, you don't need to consider all rings. Rings of matrices are just enough. So, he defined R of S equal S of S. If you know, if it's a sort of a definition, if you want. If and only if, for any D, and for all matrices, so usually I think of having M variables for some M, for any matrices D1, D2, Dm, in M of the field, you have R of, let me call it this double D, equals exactly, these are numerical things, S of D. Maybe, let me just forget the S, we can subtract them one from the other, so I just want to define when something is zero. Okay? We are R of D zero. Okay. So that makes sense. And now you have to write it whenever defined. Because even if you don't divide by something that's identically zero, which you are not allowed to do, sometimes the matrix that you produce, you want to take an inverse of it, and it's not invertible. So you just care about this being true whenever it's defined. So there's a domain to every expression, and just in the domain. You have a question, Dominic?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, okay. So this is a definition, and here comes an amazing theorem, absolutely amazing, which is essential for all developments. It's a theorem by Amitsur. Is that this condition is equivalent to having the same condition and demanding only the determinant seemingly a much, much, much weaker condition. We are going into matrices of size a million, right, which can be definitely non-zero, but not invertible. These two are equivalent. Okay, and that's combined with the next theorem, we'll show you how we are getting close to the questions we are asking now. But so that's the theorem by Amitsur, and it really it enters several places. We will see some And for those who know, the place it is coming from is the fact that the generic ring of matrices is a division ring. Somehow, you keep having here, in a slightly different context, you evaluate matrices and they are all either invertible or zero. Okay.
Obviously, not upper bound on little d.
Ah, that will be the key to the whole rest of the talk. Yes, very good. So it's a very natural question to say, what do you say for all d? Maybe we can stop somewhere. Yeah, it's a very good question. We'll get to this. So let me proceed. More questions. Yeah.
So with that definition, we can have two formulae that I could learn, but don't have the same domain.
Yeah, they don't. We care only about the intersection of their domain. So subtract them, we are there. Terms of not constant matrices, but rather matrices of commuting variables. And then it's true for everything. Okay. Anyway, so I now want to move to a theorem of Kohn, which I left valiant here for comparison, and goes back to some questions that I was asked before. What is the equivalent of, Is there a canonical question that you can ask, like determinant, canonical computational question, or polynomial, that you can ask that captures all word problems in the non-commutative system? And that's exactly what Kohn did. He did many things, and we will keep quoting him. But here's the result of Kohn, which is a generalization of valiant theorem. It proves small. It works also in the commutative setting. And it was proved in 71. But of course, nobody knows this literature. I'm serious. I mean, there are books that he wrote and other people wrote, and most of them are very hard to penetrate. So some of these years were spent penetrating some of these books and results. Here is a result. I want to say it's similarly, so let's say that f is maybe it's for half x is in. So a formula or an expression, they call it usually an expression, and we can say of size x. Some sizes, then there exists, again, symbolic matrix, which is also 2s by 2s, or maybe 3s by 3s, in the same variables, such that R is completely equivalent to what? So you asked yesterday what's analog determinant. Simply, we saw in the first lecture singular or the inversion problem was somehow miraculously, luckily equivalent to determinant in the commutative system. Otherwise, you stick with it. You invert this matrix. Just look at this inverse, it's another symbolic matrix. Okay. and you look at the one-one expression, so essentially there are rational functions also. The rational function is a matrix of linear forms, so matrix series of linear forms. Its inverse is a matrix of rational functions, so the elements of L inverse ij are also in this free space field. And you look at any entry you pick, and it's, it evaluates the expression you want. So formulas are reducible to inverses. Just like in the commutative setting, only we never write it this way. We could have written in this way, the inverse is a ratio of determinants. Okay, so this was proved. How was it proved? By induction, it's a little harder. You can find, I think, so there's several proofs of this. Kwan did one, and Malcolmson did the one, and there's another one in my paper with Pavel. That's a slight variant. Anyway, they're all simple, follow the same recipe, and slightly more complicated, because you need to deal with it. Yeah?
So what is the generalization of the
theorem? Well, it's not obvious, but when you look at this construction, you see it works in the commutative setting. And it does even inverse. You don't have to do inverse if you don't want, but on the other hand, here you could do inverse also. So. Yeah.
You said there's a simple intuition behind the measure.
Yeah, it's sort of graph theory. It's right. About cycle
charts. Does it apply here?
You can do it, or you can just. I mean, you don't have. I mean, there's an intuitive reason, but even if you believe that it's possible, then there's a way. That's not the only way to do it. This entirely. That's a slick way of doing it. You don't have to do it.
What are the requirements about that L sub R? Its entry should be linear.
The linear form, linear symbolic matrix is always the same. Symbolic matrix, it's a tuple of, right? It's a linear combination. Where is it? There is always some AI X sum.
And the number of AIs in it? Oh, it's
just it's all the same.
Yeah.
It's never more than quadratic in the size. So what can we conclude now if we combine Kwan's theorem with an Amitsov theorem? Right, just look at it. We know when something is zero, when this determinant is zero. And, well, it takes a slide. Let me just tell you a corollary. It takes a slide. Two lines of algebra. R of x is identical to zero, so that's our work problem. If and only if, for every d, in every d1, MD of F, the determinant of the sum. So this is my linear form. The sum of. So let's say that the linear form corresponding to R, let's say that L sub R is just A1. Yeah. Okay, so we did a conreduction, we got a linear symbolic matrix, so it gave us this set of matrices. This is it, so there's a direct correspondence between these two. This is expression is zero exactly if AI, what do I do now? How do I plug in into a variable matrix? Just take the temporal problem. Right, so this follows directly from the combination of Amitsov's theorem and Kwan's theorem. Okay, regular rational expression corresponds to a symbolic matrix. You want to know whether this symbolic matrix, so another way of saying, I'll state it differently. Let me say, But this is also cool, but maybe I'll just say another one. Let me say just another corollary, which is I would not skip the rational expression. Simply L, which is A1 to AN, is non-commutatively singular. It requires a couple of lines of algebra. So you have to translate the problem of inversion to the problem of testing whether it equals zero before you invert. But I'll skip this. The original problem we had, just testing whether a matrix is a symbolic matrix non-commutatively singular, is translated to a sequence of conditions, right? Infinite sequence of conditions. You just have to test them all, and then you know. And we prove that testing this condition is in P1. That's the main. That's the main result. That's the consequence of the algorithm. I want to point out that in the, if you want to think about the commutative singularity, we also have a similar expression which we discussed already. So it is commutatively singular. So this is in parentheses. If and only if we don't need all d, we just need if for every, let's say, delta 1, delta m in the field, the determinant of some AI. Right? So in the commutative setting, we need just a one-dimensional matrix. In the non-commutative setting, we need to plug in matrices of larger and larger size. But if all of them are satisfied, then this non-commutative is singular. Otherwise, it's not. Okay, so you just, yeah.
So, where did you get the expression of the inset determinant from R of
two? I'm just plugging in these matrices to the, I'm plugging in the matrix to the variable. This is, if you think of a matrix, what happens is, say, a variable is sitting there. You replace it by a matrix. So that's a tensor part.
How is that choosing the problem? I'm saying how we get the L minus 1 first coordinate.
Yeah, so you can, so in particular, this is for computing. You can just, this is stronger than what we need. You can just ask, when is L equals 0? L equals 0 is if you have 0 in this coordinate. Okay. And you can translate this with a little bit of work to asking whether this a matrix is invertible, sort of testing whether something is identical with it. It's a little bit of work. It's not. It's in my paper with Pavel, for example, for those who want to see it. I just wanted to see the contrast. So, one thing I achieved here is finally I gave you an elementary description. Description that does not need the knowledge of anything from anything in non-commutative algebra, script 15 in particular. There's a condition here. When is something non-commutatively singular? It's just when all these expressions are satisfied, and this is similar to when this is to the commutative set. Okay, only that you need to take tensor powers. Okay, and we will come back. This is an absolutely fundamental thing. Remember, and one particular question to ask, which is a question Ryan asked: do you need for all the, right? Can you stop at some particular finite d, let's say, depending on L, or even better, depending just on N? And the answer is yes, and we will see it. So, okay. So this is all you have to remember for now. That's a definition of non-commutative singularity, even if you didn't follow how we got to this. Okay, so now, more questions. But we actually already defined. So okay, it's not obvious that you think, yeah?
Yeah, I'm just trying to understand this. So, during this conviction of the determinant of start of AI in terms of AI being zero, but isn't this the case where AI is not interpretable? So I'm not understanding.
Singular. It's singular if all of them are zero. Also here, it's singular if all of the, you know.
So singular means somehow that it's not to be defined, right? It's a universe that doesn't exist.
Yeah, but don't worry about this one. As I said, you can read it in my paper, you can do it in 5 minutes. As well, see that Kant's theorem is actually stronger than this thing. It falls. Don't worry about it. So we have the question that Ryan asked here is, does some, you know, well, exists, I mean that if it's not singular, namely, this is not zero somewhere, then it's already not zero at some distance. The function of it. The answer would be yes, obviously. It's not clear that it's well defined, but it is defined. So, and in fact, in the paper with the Pavel, we showed that removing division. Moving divisions from non-commutative formulas is polynomial in this number. So if you have a formula of size n, then you can with division, which computes a polynomial, so the same result as Strassen's result. You are computing a polynomial, so presumably you don't need division, right? But you are using division in computation. If you have a good bound on this, then you can compute this polynomial without division. So just the analog of Strassen's result. And as it turns out, this will be polynomial, so there is always sufficient division. In fact, that's when the connection to invariant theory started. I'll tell you why. It's related to invariant theory, which we realized already. And we asked invariant theorists about this, and eventually they provided the answer. And I'll prove to you the bound on this stuff. But anyway, so the one consequence is division can be eliminated from non-commutative formulas if you care. That's not the main thing. Okay. So why is it, what? So I'm going to tell you some stories about invariant theory, but just I want to just point out one important thing that was you've seen again and again, but you probably didn't think about it this way. Why is invariant theory related? I just want to claim that the question of non-commutative singularity does not depend if we change bases on the left or if we change bases on the right. In fact, we utilize it in the algorithm. If I give you a tuple of matrices and you pre-multiply it by a non-singular matrix or post-multiply a non-singular matrix, the question is whether it's non-commutatively singular doesn't change. Same for commutatively singular, it doesn't matter. But the fact that you are allowed to pre-multiply by any group element on the left, pre-multiply by any group element on the right, namely x by a group element, x by a group, by the product of these two groups, this is, you know, should those of you who know, your ears should ring with invariant theory. There's a group action on the object you are interested in. Maybe it helps understanding. Maybe it helps understanding in particular this kind of question. Okay. So let's see, let me tell you some stories on invariant theory.
So you put this last, so you think if we have a bound on this stuff, then you could remove.
Yeah, that's a theorem from HW.
Yeah, Like if you only care had matrices of size B, then
yeah, so if your formula is of size n, okay, you have a formula of size n with divisions computing a polynomial. So maybe you don't know Strassen's result, but it's exactly the same, it's completely analogous. In the commutative setting, if you have a formula of size n computing a polynomial that has divisions in it, there's another formula computing the same polynomial. It's polynomial size in n. Well, n and the degree. Similarly, well, in fact, formula, you don't need the degree. So just in n. Similarly, only polynomial will depend on n, and on this number, which we didn't know, but today we know is a polynomial. Okay, so you can always do this also. Okay. So we are switching topics. And extent, I'll teach you about this to be the same extent I taught you about screw fields, which was 15 minutes long. So I don't know how many people here are math majors, but even if you are, not, it's not a topic that was always taught in undergrad curriculum. It's an amazingly beautiful topic which studies symmetries, just a study of symmetries, group action of symmetries are the same thing. It's not only extremely important for mathematics, it's of course extremely important for physics. All modern physics relies on invariant theory. All the forces of nature are really group action. So, of course, I'm not going there. So, maybe I'll tell you, even though of the number of details I take, let me very briefly tell you just a sort of riddle from the beginning of invariant theory. Invariant theory was really, attributed to Cayley in a paper he calls On the Problem of Linear Algebra. An amazingly beautiful paper and very important to developments that happened since this work I'm telling you about, but I'm not going there. Really nice example of invariance and invariant theory is the following problem. I ask you whether, I give you here a square, let's say, of size, I give you a square and I give you a triangle. And I ask, can I convert them from one into the other? And what am I allowing you to do? Think of these as pieces of paper. I'm allowing you scissors that you can cut in straight lines. And you can move things in the plane any way you want. No overlaps, right? So whether you can move from this to this by just cutting a finite number of times, rearranging and putting it together. When can you do this? What's the answer? Excuse me? Yeah, area. Okay, so first of all, it's clearly a necessary condition if you are doing this that they have the same area. So this is it's object A and object S and T. Area of S has to be the same as area of T. You cannot do it otherwise, of course. But it turns out that this is if and only if. It's a theorem that I leave you as an exercise, it's not a difficult exercise. Okay? And what are the shapes? Polygons. I have to say what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about circles. Polygons. Okay? So any two polygons of the same area you can convert one to the other by this cutting and rearranging. I'm not formally defining it, but that's a group. These things that you are allowed to do, you can always invert. It's an identity, so it's a group action. This is in R2. Suppose we now move, it doesn't have to be convex. So now suppose we move to sort of polytop, not necessarily convex, in R3. I should say, this, remember, this is an invariant. It's an invariant. When you do this cutting and moving around, the total area of the pieces does not change. That's what invariant means. It's like invariant you learn in physics, you know, some chemical reaction or physical reaction, energy is preserved, mass is preserved, momentum is preserved. These are invariant. Okay, so here we have an invariant of some group action, and it turns out it's the only invariant. And one basic question of invariant theory is characterize all the invariants. Okay, you have some group action, characterize all the invariants. What happens with polytops in R3? What is an obvious invariant? Volume. Very good. So, volume is an invariant. Is there another invariant? Can you move any two polygons of the same volume to each other when now you have a saw instead of scissors? Not the same thing. Anybody knows? Well, first of all, yeah, it's nice to tell these stories and some of them. So first of all, it's a famous problem. This is Hilbert's third problem. In the famous list of Hilbert's problems, that he made in the year 1900 for the International Mathematical Union, he asked this. That was only one of his questions. He was very interested in invariant theory, we'll soon see. He asked this question. And of all the questions he asked, this was the easiest. Like a couple of months later, his student, Max Dehn, this is another very important invariant theorist, answered it. What do you think the answer is?
There's another invariant.
There's another invariant, yeah. So there is also, this is one invariant, and there is Dehn's invariant. It's very hard to discover, I'm telling you this, although it's intuitive. It has to do with the angles in the polygon, polytops, and the sizes of edges in them. And it's some nice combination of them. But in particular, he showed that this proof that if you take a cube and a simplex of the same volume, you cannot transform the number. Okay, so that's a story. Now, we are going to be interested in linear actions. Yes?
Is it clear that suppose we have all the invariants, now we have two objects which have the same invariant property, but is it necessary that I should be able to go from one to the other?
Yeah, that's what it means. Complete set of invariant means exactly that.
But the computation of the actual transformation.
Very good. So, we are going to deal with the computational questions. Computationally, there's a lot. It's one of the more computational areas of mathematics, invariant theory. There are lots of books called Algorithm for Invariant Theory or Computational Invariant Theory. They care about computing invariants. And I'll tell you what kind of invariants in particular. And the computational complexity is extremely interesting. So we would ask not just list invariants, but, you know, what is the computational complexity to tell whether two objects are the same?
Or to do the conversion.
Yeah, or to move, yeah, or to find the group element moving one to the other. Yes. So there are all these questions. We are going to restrict ourselves to looking at linear group action. So this is an action. Maybe I should define action in general. So, just to define, this just means, an action just means that, so this is some set, maybe I should call it omega. This just means that G omega is in omega for every G in G, and omega in omega. And you have what you expect, that GH omega is the same as g h omega. And inverse, and you know, it's composed with the group. This action is friendly with the group. Okay. So that's an action in general, and what we are going to look at is just groups that act on vector spaces. So you can always think of this as part of GLK. So actions on a linear space, this is a group of matrices. We are going to look just at this type of action. So these are called linear actions. Linear. So you think of this as a vector, this is a matrix, matrix acting on a vector. We are going to only look at this. And now, if you identify this, you can think of pick a basis as the basis k elements. Okay, so you can just think of acting of linear combinations of these variables. It's the same thing acting on the vector space. Now you can extend this action to acting on the full polynomial. Once you have an action on the variables, linear actions, it also transforms polynomials to polynomials in the So G acts. Maybe I should write it like this. G also acts on the polynomial ring. And what we are going to look for is polynomial invariance of this action. Okay. So what do I mean by polynomial invariance? I'll denote by this vector space. I'll denote by V. V sub G, so this is called the invariant ring, the ring of invariant polynomials under the action, is simply all polynomials in this polynomial ring. By the way, now we are commutative, use square brackets. All of invariant theory is commutative. All polynomials, when you act on them, by the group, they don't change. That's why they are invariant. GP equals P. Okay? Now you've seen this thing. Let me give you a couple of examples to remind you that you've seen these invariant things. Let me give you a couple of examples. G is the symmetric group of k letters, and it acts on these k letters as permutations, so permuting the set of k elements. All right. So in particular, if I give you a polynomial, this permutes the names of the variables. What are the invariant polynomials? Yeah, symmetric polynomials, that's why they are non-symmetric polynomials, so good. So here V sub G, so this is a so reaction, and so here V is F to the K, it will always be F to the K. V sub G is a set of all symmetric polynomials. And I already want to tell you that one basic question in invariant theory, two questions, is to prove the first fundamental theorem and the second fundamental theorem. What's the first fundamental theorem? Is finding generators for these rings, as compact as possible, as nice as possible. The second fundamental theorem is to find relationships between, algebraic relations between these invariants. But we'll stick to the first one. What generates a symmetric polynomial? The elementary symmetric polynomials. So I could write the elementary symmetric polynomials, or I could also write, elementary symmetric. All this. And the elementary symmetric of degree k Right? It's enough to take the first k ones and then generate. In fact, there are k ones and k powers. So it's nice. These are polynomials that not are just concise. There are few of them. There are just k of them. They are easy to compute, right? Elementary symmetric polynomials are easy to compute. So it's really a completely nice, very nice solution to this problem. We understand everything about it. Here's another example that we fully understand. Now, G is going to be SLN of F squared. So left and right, change of basis. And G is going to act.
Do you want n equals k?
No, no. Actually, k will equal n squared.
Oh.
I'm going to act on mn of F. And the way it's acting is gm is really, well, if G is, let's say, let's call it for some mysterious reason, R and C, right? Left and right multiplication of this matrix. This is so SLN is just matrix as invertible of determinant 1. GM is simply R and C. Right? So there are n squared variables here, right? We are acting on them linearly, right? We are just computing linear combinations of this matrix. The new matrix is a matrix of linear forms in the original variable, right? For every fixed R and C. What is an invariant polynomial that you can know? Good. What is another invariant polynomial that you can know? Well, no. VG is generated by the determinant. There's only, so that's a, right, that's a polynomial. Notice that always these are polynomials in the variables z1 through zk. This is the only invariant. It's not hard to prove. You learned probably enough college algebra to know this or to prove this. But again, it's a very concise description of it. So all others are just powers of this. But when I say algebra, I said that I called it an invariant ring or invariant algebra. You can. Say this, but you should see that it's an algebra. You can add two of them and they remain invariant. You can multiply two of them and they remain invariant. So it's an algebra. So here, all the invariants are just powers of the determinant, nothing else. Okay. So we understand this fully. And what action would we like to understand? Well, obvious. We like to understand the generalization of these two several matrices. So example 3, which is our example, is where the same G is SLN F. And I write here SLN, even though in some cases we discussed GLN, that's the right thing to look at. So this is what we will look at. I'm not explaining this. Acting on A1, AM, right? So R and C act on this. That's simply R in 1, C, R. So, suddenly we are in familiar territory, right? This is something we would like to understand. It's not clear why we need to understand, it's not clear yet, why we need to understand the polynomial invariance of this action. By the way, I didn't say it, but and it's not obvious. There are other invariants of this action. I can take any invariant polynomial and maybe e to the p is another invariant, or log p is another invariant, the sine of p is another invariant. But it turns out that polynomial invariants capture all invariants. All invariants, as they say in math, factor through the polynomial invariant. They are defined by the polynomial. So for linear actions, all you need to understand, all the invariants are polynomial. Okay, so here we have polynomial invariants. We want to know what the polynomial invariants are. And this is more or less where Pavel and I stood. We understood that we need to figure out this. And then we had to look at various invariant theory papers And yeah, they didn't. The recent result. So this was the result for this action, this particular action. It was open for a long time. Other actions like simultaneous conjugation, another very natural action, is just you conjugate. You have just one SLM and you conjugate the type of matrices. So this was understood in the 70s by Processi, who really sort of developed the techniques for building interesting invariant twins. But this was open until about 2000, where several groups, Dirksen and Weyman, Domokos and Zubkov, Schofield and Vanderberg, maybe more, somehow simultaneously figured out what this looks like. And if you look at these papers, you are not going to see what I'm telling you. But it took us time to see that it's equivalent, but it's equivalent. I have no idea why they didn't write it in this form, and you will not be surprised to when I tell you that V sub G is generated by the following polynomials. Determinant, let me, maybe the matrix here is the. So, by the way, what is K here? K here is m times n squared, right? These are, right? So if we think of the variables here, maybe I should denote it. So each of them is n by n matrix of, so there are z, ij, m, n. Okay, these are the values. We are acting on all these matrices simultaneously. We said that these are indexing our vector spaces, a natural description of the vector space. And it turns out that this is so it's exactly the same expression as that. I should highlight this. Exactly the same expression. I only put zi because we look at the variables, so we want polynomials in these variables. So maybe I should have put, just to be consistent, maybe I should have put z here. So magically, these are two independent fields that care about completely different issues. And this exact same expression, of course not, coincidence, but same expression comes up in both. And now, yeah.
Does this imply that quadratic?
Yes, it does. And it turns out that it does, the implication in the other direction is not obvious. But, yeah, this implies this. This is just about testing zero. This is more general. Right? What was the invariant theory question? I give you two objects. What is this? I give you two objects like this, and I ask you whether one they can be transformed by a group action from one to the other. What you do is test. That's all the invariants. If all the invariants are equal, like in the geometric picture. Now I'm cheating a bit. It's not quite correct what I'm saying, but that's the essence of it. Okay, so let's see. You should be impressed, and I'll check the time. And okay, good. So I have about 15 more minutes, or something like this. I started late. Yeah?
Okay, this is the last question. What implies what here?
The fact that this is the invariant ring of this action implies that, but okay, you have to, not just alone, but with some of the definitions and things we've seen, implies this. But the important thing here is that what invariant theory is doing in particular, like I told you, they want to understand the generators of invariant rings, make it simpler, and in particular, try to get this set finite to begin with, this an infinite set. Right. So now we go back to Hilbert, and I'll tell you some things that started with Hilbert. So again, we can ask this, is it finite? In fact, Hilbert, already in 90, so I mean 1890, proved, well, it's not the same D, but in fact, he didn't prove it, he didn't care about this action. What he really proved is that VG is always finitely generated. So in particular, there's an upper bound on G. He didn't prove an upper bound, just said that it's finite. It's always finitely generated. In this context, linear actions. It's actually reductive group actions, but we don't have to know anything about this. Many people don't realize this, but this was his main objective. When I say his main objective, this is a paper that everybody knows. This is a paper that proves the Lusanza's theorem. This is a paper that proves the finite basis theorem. It's all the same paper and proves all these things that have other extremely important implications throughout mathematics. But he wanted this corollary. This is what he was after. That's the result he wanted. He was very interested in invariant theory. For this, he developed all this machinery. So we know it's finite. Now we want bounds on this. And people look at bounds on this. And again, in general, for reductive group actions, Popov. So if I'm thinking of n here, or maybe k here, scale, Popov proved that degrees. So you can bound the degrees in the invariant things by something like exponential. And then, Dirksen, which I keep mentioning, also around 2000, proved the degrees k, I guess. K is my parameter, the size of the action group, is at most exponential.
So that n is also k?
Yes, so k is there. Yeah. So in our case, k is, right, for us, k is polynomial in n, right?
So he didn't write degrees for that, can I?
Yeah, so what I mean is that the polynomial, so in this I just mean that the invariant ring VG is generated by polynomials of this degree.
I don't quite fully understand the definition of this, but does that give the same bound on
D star? Yes, it does, but I didn't show how. Yeah. It does give the same bound, but not the other direction. Because that is just about testing zero, and this is about all invariants. Right, so you have two objects, you evaluate all of these numbers on them, and you get a variety of numbers. And you know that if you get the same for the two objects, then you know they are equivalent. There, you know, you want, you just ask the question, is my object, is the zero object, is identical to the zero object under the group action? And if all of them, if you evaluate all of them, so you plug the AI here, and you always get zero. Then you are equivalent to the zero object, which in our sense, in our setting, is simply being non-commutatively singular. It's actually it's a little stronger, right? It sits above. Like in Valiant, the determinant is a bit higher than formulas. There's no, the reverse direction is quasi-polynomial. Also here, it's higher, maybe more higher, maybe much higher. But this inversion is complete. Yeah.
But these bounds, you call it degrees, it's bound for what?
For the degrees of polynomials in the regenerate the environment.
But degrees are bounded by k times d or something.
No. It's look. It's for all d.
Ah, so it's bounded essentially for d.
I'm saying that for any group action, not just this group action, it's a particular group action. For all linear group actions, if the acting group is a subgroup of GLMK, it's K by K matrices acting, then the degrees are bounded by these numbers and functions of K. That's a, yeah. The results are complicated results. So now, what should I do? I was hoping to do two things. Maybe I'll just do, well, of course I'll do at most one. One is to show even a better bound on this, well, this I'll do tomorrow. I'll show a better bound on this degree for this particular action. I said that it's polynomial for this action. So I want to eventually prove to you a polynomial, much better than this bound on this action. But what I'll do now is I'll tell you what we actually did in the paper GGW1. What we realized finally is that these bounds, this exponential bound, which of course were totally useless for division elimination, they are actually enough to prove the capacity lower bound and therefore the polynomial convergence of the algorithm. So even though exponential degree, I want to show you that. So let me do it. I'll do it sketchily and maybe we can. It's not the tensor product of operator, it's something below it, but doesn't matter, so I have some notation for it. It's something that we live in nd dimensions. So I do the obvious, A1 tensor V1. A2 tensor V2. Am tensor Vn. So these matrices live in M and D of F, right? Okay. So remember we have this notion of capacity. Again, I realize I'm jumping between areas here and between topics and you should switch in context all the time. And, I need to give you time to go back. This is a notion of capacity. We want to bound the capacity of any operator that has non-zero capacity. We know it's non-zero, and we want a lower bound that is already exponential. Right? Now, I told you, and this is written here somewhere, that, so here's what I want to prove. I want to prove that if capacity of L is greater than zero, and remember again, these are entry 0, 1, let's say, I'm not worried about bit size here, then capacity of L. So this is the main theorem of T0W1. And you will see, just at the end, it's a combination of all these things. There's nothing very complicated in it. Maybe I need to put square here. Let's see about that. Or maybe, yeah. Some constant. So how do you prove this? What? Sorry?
One direction
of these. Yeah, one direction of these, very good, yeah. I already told you that Gurwitz gave us a start, right? He said that if L is commutatively singular, so another way of saying it, if there exists some, maybe delta I, so that some AI, delta I, the determinant, right? Suppose there exists some delta I in the field, so that this is different than zero, yes? Then this already implies the capacity of L is what we want. And the main problem is that this is not generally the case. I mean, a matrix can be non-commutatively non-singular, but decommutatively singular. So what do we do? I mean, L doesn't satisfy it. And the answer is obvious because of this. So in fact, I just erased what I needed. Anyway, what this says is that, well, what I had on the board said, maybe I should just put it back. L is non-commutatively singular if and only if non-commutatively, say, let me put it non-singular, if and only if there exists a D and there exists D1 Dm, such that the determinant of some AI sense of DI is not zero, right? And we know two things. One thing we know, right, so let me, yeah, so one thing we know by Dirksen, we know that D is at most, what? Exponential in some polynomial in N. Right. This we know by Dirksen. We know another thing by Schwarz-Lippert. I mean, once this is true, you know that you can pick the DIs randomly and never satisfy it. It's the same thing as the Schwarz-Lippert. And actually, these entries of these matrices do not have to be very large. They can be, they can have a polynomial in these size entries. So, because that's a degree bound, the degree will be n times d. So these di's, I don't know, jk, are the most exponential in d in size, so they are just described by d bits. We need both of these facts, and now you see it's one line, and that will be the end of that. Okay, so recapping. We know that if the space of matrices.
What space is
bit size is polynomial. I think that's, oh, maybe you need polynomial. Polynomial. Good. I don't think it would have mattered, but yeah. The main magic is that an exponential degree bound suffices. So, but it's not clear what we are going to do, so let me tell you what we are doing. If we are in a non-singular, what does this mean? It means that the space of matrices contains some non-singular matrix in it, right? If a space contains non-singular matrix in it, we have a good law on capacity in terms of the dimension, right? But we don't. But this theorem, or that theorem, guarantees that in some tensor power, if the matrix is non-commutatively singular, in some tensor power, we have a non-singular matrix. Right, that's what means that the determinant is non-zero. So let's move there. So we know, so forget this for a second, we know that the capacity of, so we know that there exists this K, which has the, so K is this tuple, D1, Dn, with the D which is the exponential N. Oh, yeah. And the small entries and the n small entries. Right? That I can. Bound the capacity using the same Gurwitz argument, because this is already a space which contains a non-singular matrix. Is, so tell me what should I put here? ND. Let me forget the O. Right? So I'm just applying this one. But this U is exponentially larger. So the other thing we need, which is very simple to prove, and I will not prove it, I'll leave it as an exercise, is what is the relationship between the capacity of this object to the capacity of this object that we want? And there's a very simple relation. It's a lemma we proved. It's actually, there's a more, a deeper theorem which I will not say, which is the following. Capacity of L tensor K is at most the capacity of L to the D and the capacity of K to the N. There is a, right, the reverse exponent. What is really the right measure to look at is the normalized measure, if you want. You always should take the root of the capacity, if I have not the capacity bar of L on M bits to be capacity of L to the power 1 over n, this, if I took this expression, then I would get that this, what it really says is capacity L times OK, bar, most capacity of L, bar. Bar. That's really the right way to remember why you have the reverse of it. You take the nd root of both and then you get it. What? No, that's how it is. It's just some multiplicity. This normalized capacity. It's very easy to prove. I mean, it's really easy to prove because capacity is the infimum. Where is capacity defined? It's the infimum over all these PSD matrices. And you just say to yourself, it's the infimum, so I might as well assume that P is a tensor product of an N by N matrix and the D by D matrix. And moreover, you put the D by D matrix to be identity matrix. Just because it's an infimum, you can do this. And there it's a very simple thing. It's, yeah, one last. Okay, so that's the exercise. And now, let's just apply it. So we know this. So we know capacity of L tensor K, at least ND minus ND. And this is capacity of L to the D, capacity okay, to the end. And this is because, I'm not going to do it because you want to eat lunch, because the D's have small entries, and because you can replace the PSD matrix by identity, this depends just on determinants of these matrices, D sub I's, and we can bound. So this is small, small enough. But the important thing is this D that appears here, because this D kills this D. It doesn't kill this D, but kills this D. And this D is only exponential input. So basically what you get, so forget the small thing which you can calculate, what you get at the end is capacity of L is at most nd to the minus n, and d was exponential in n. And that was enough for the analysis. So once we learned this lesson result, okay, so I think I exhausted my welcome or question. Sorry, I started at 10:04. Questions? Yes.
Is the exponential dependence on D normally tight?
It's not normally tight. And as far as I know, I think it's not normally tight. For the left right action, I'll show you tomorrow the polynomial for now. And yeah, that's right. Okay, thanks. So tomorrow will be mainly analysis, but I will finish what I owe you here about the algebra and the upper bound, the polynomial upper bound.